Hello everyone, we will take up the entity relationship model in detail in this chapter for database design. We have already seen in the last lecture that we have the conceptual or the high level design, we have a logical design and we have a physical design. For the conceptual or the high level design, we are using the conceptual model. And we will show the conceptual model using the entity relationship model, or commonly also called the ER model. For the logical design, we will take up the representational model, and like I have told you earlier, we will do the relational model for the representational model over here. Some other representational models are object-oriented model, hierarchical model and network model, but with the relational database management systems we use the relational model. And the physical design, that is implemented through the physical model. Now, like I told you, in this lecture we will take up the conceptual or the high level model using the entity relationship model in detail. High level model, we know it is for specifying the requirements of the users. That means we draw the high level model to specify what are the requirements of the users, and these requirements then they become an agreement between the user and the developer that what should be included in the database. And also this model, it will help the designers to implement it in the next level, which is our logical design or the representational model. The diagrammatic notation which is associated with the ER model is known as the ER diagram. So, here I have shown you an ER diagram for a company database, which is consisting of some objects like employee, department, project. Then we have shown the attributes of these objects. Here we have shown the attributes for the departments, we have shown the attributes for the project. Then we have some relationships, works for, manages and works on, and attributes of the relationships. So, all this that I have shown you in this ER diagram, we are going to study one by one. All the notations that I have used in this ER diagram, they are predefined specific notations for different types of objects, relationships and the attributes. So, the entity relationship approach, it consists of three important things: entities, attributes and relationships. Now, what is an entity? An entity is a thing in the real or the mini world with some independent existence. For example, I say student is an entity in some mini world. We have a mini world which is consisting of the college. So, I can say a student is an entity there, a faculty is an entity there, a classroom is an entity in the college. So, anything that exists in the mini world or the real world is called an entity, and the entity is represented in the ER diagram with the by a rectangle with the name of the rectangle. For example, I have shown the entity employee over here as a rectangle, and within it I have written the name of the entity, that is employee. Similarly for student. Now, what is an attribute? An attribute, it is the property that describes the entity. An entity can have any number of attributes, and in the ER model, we will consider the attributes that are of interest to us. For example, let us say for the project, there is an entity project. The attributes that we need in our database are the name, the number and the location. There can be other attributes for projects. For example, it can be who is the mentor of the project, how many students are registered for the project, but we are not concerned with those properties in our database. Hence, we will consider only the properties that we are interested in as the attributes. An attribute in the ER diagram is given by a oval sign with the name of the attribute written within it. Let's look at these examples. We have the entity project and three attributes which are shown by oval over here, and they are joined to the entity. I have numbered some of the attributes which underlined some of the attributes which we will take up later. I have another example over here. The entity is the employee, and these are some of the attributes: SSN, BDate, name, though the attribute name has been divided again, we will do that, address, salary, and sex. So, an entity in the ER diagram is shown by a rectangle with the name of the entity, and the attributes or the properties of every entity, they are shown by the oval and joined to the entity using the line. An entity can have any number of attributes as per the requirement of the system. There are different categories of the attributes in the ER model. These are the simple and composite attributes, single valued and multi valued attributes, stored and derived attributes, and the complex attributes. Now, what is a atomic or a simple attribute? A simple attribute is that which cannot be divided into subparts. For example, let's say I have this attribute location. I divide it into subparts saying house number, street, and city. So, it no longer is a simple attribute because it has been divided into subparts. A simple attribute, it cannot be defined into subparts. It is an atomic attribute. So, we will not have any subparts over here. Whereas, a composite attribute is that which can be divided into subparts. For example, we have shown over here, we have name as an attribute. Here it is. And we have divided it into F name, M init, and L name. Why? Because our system, our database system requires that for the name of any person or the employee, we store the first name, F name, the initial, and the L name separately. So, we have divided this attribute name into three different subparts, and such an attribute is called a composite attribute. A single valued attribute means an attribute that can have only a single value for a particular entity. That means, let's say for the employee, let's say I have an attribute name. Now, an employee can have only one name. An employee cannot have two names. There is another attribute, age. An employee can have only a single age. So, any attribute that can have only a single value for a particular entity is called a single valued attribute. Whereas, a multi-valued attribute is that which can have multiple values for a particular entity. Again, let's look at location over here. Location is an attribute for the department. A department can have multiple locations. Another multi-valued attribute I can give is for employee, I can say that phone is a multi-valued attribute. Why? Because an employee can have more than one phone number. A multi-valued attribute in the ER diagram is shown by a double oval, whereas a single value attribute is shown as a single oval. Then we have the stored and the derived attributes. The attributes that we have done till now, they are the stored attributes, like we said SSN, okay? For employee, SSN is a attribute and it has some value that will be stored in the database. Similarly, let us have salary, it will have some value that will be stored in the database. A derived attribute is an attribute which can be derived from some other attribute. For example, we have this attribute age over here. So, this age can be derived from the attribute birth date. So, it is called a derived attribute, and a derived attribute is always shown by a dashed line. Then next we have other complex attributes. The complex attributes are those which are a combination of the composite and the multivalued attributes. Here we have a multivalued attribute for employee, which is phone, and also it is a composite attribute. Why is it a composite attribute? Because it is consisting of two parts, the STT code and the number. Right, we can say that there is a student, the student may have two addresses. Let us say the student has a permanent address and a correspondence address, and each of the address will have a house number, a street, a city, and a state. So, we have the composite attribute address and also the attribute address. It is a multivalued address because a student can have more than one address. So, these are the different types of attributes that are there in the ER diagram. And which attribute we are using, whether we are using a simple attribute or we are using a multivalued attribute or we are using a stored attribute, it actually depends upon the requirement of the database, that what is the type of the data in the database. Now, what is an entity type? Look, when I talk of a student as an entity. A student means we are representing a group of entities that are similar. Why are they similar? Because we are talking of similar properties or attributes for them. For example, for the student, I say the student has a student number, a name, and age, which are the attributes that we are using. Then for every student, there will be a number of students. For every student that exists, there will be a student number, there will be a name, there will be an age. Another student, let's say, there will be a student number, there will be a name, and there will be a age, and so on. So, this means that an entity type, it is a collection of the entities that have the same properties. All the students in the class have the same properties of interest in our database. That is, the properties of interest for the student are student number, name, and the age. So, all the students, they are having the same properties of interest, and hence we say that the student is a entity type, and the entity is a instance of the entity type. That means, if we have the entity type student, then the entity represented by student number 1, name and age 23 is an instance or occurrence of the entity type student, or we can say it is an entity type of the entity type student. Each entity type in the database is described by its name and attributes. Let's look at same what I told you earlier. We have employee over here, and the attributes of interest for the employee are employee number, name and age. So, this is a entity type. The occurrences are employee number 1 E1, sorry, the employee E1, right, given by 1 as the employee number, Amit as the name and 60 as the age. Then we have the employee E2 given by 2 employee number, name, age. So, the entity type is the employee, and the entity set or the group of entities are these, the occurrences of the entities. Now, next is key attributes of an entity type. Key attributes means that an entity type usually has one or more attributes whose values are distinct for each individual entity in the entity set. Now, what does this mean? An entity type, I have the entity type student, it has one or more attributes whose values are distinct for each individual entity, means each occurrence in the entity set. So, I have 3 entities over here in the entity set corresponding to the entity type employee E1, E2 and E3. So, now what is a key? A key is a one or more attributes. So, if I say over here ENO is the key, okay. If I say ENO is the key, then ENO should have the property that the value of ENO is distinct for each individual entity in the entity set. What does that mean? The value of ENO is distinct for each individual entity in the entity set. Let's see for the rest of the attributes. The value of Amit is not unique. Amit, E1 is also called Amit, E3 is also called Amit. The value of age is not unique. E1's age is 60, the age of E3 is 60. Even the combination, somehow E1 name is Amit, age is 60, E3 name is Amit, age is 60, but ENO is that attribute which is clearly showing us the difference, or due to which E1 and E3 are distinct. Why? Because E1 has the employee number 1 and E3 has the employee number 3. So, we will say that in this case ENO is the key, and like it's written over here, I have the example I have given you is of one attribute as the key. It can be a single attribute or the combination of attributes that will form the key, and the value of key is used to identify each entity uniquely. Because if the key was not there, what is the property of the key? That for each entity it should have a distinct value. If this was not so and the value of ENO was also 3 over here, then how would we make out a difference between these two entities in this entity set? So, the key needs to have a unique value for each entity in the entity set. The key attributes are underlined in the ER diagram. Now, let us go back to our ER diagram over here. I had told you that I have underlined some of the attributes. Here I have underlined name and number. Look, I have underlined name and number. So, name as well as number, they are key attributes. In this, it's what does it mean? It means that every department will have a unique name. Why? Because it is a key attribute. So, name should have a property that will distinct the it will distinguish between the various departments. Similarly, the number is an attribute which should have a unique value for each department. Location is not a key attribute, so it can have the same value for different departments also. Similarly, here we have underlined SSN. So, SSN is a key attribute over here. This SSN will always distinguish the various entities in the employee or the various employees that exist in the entity employee. Again, look at this example. We have two key attributes, that is registration and vehicle ID. We can have any number of key attributes. It's not that we will have only one key attribute. We can have any number of key attributes. For example, in this case, you have registration and you have vehicle ID. Ultimately, when we implement our database from this ER diagram, we will use only one of these key attributes as what later we will start calling as the primary key. Because look, the registration number for every car is going to be unique and the vehicle ID for every car is going to be unique. So, we have two categories, but then it is either for the database designer or it is for the user to specify that which key attribute we will be using as the primary key later. Now, sometimes several attributes together may form a key. If you remember the definition, one or more attributes. What did we say? One or more attributes. So, sometimes several attributes, they may together form the key. In that case, what we will do in the ER diagram is that we will, for example, two attributes, name and phone number, for a person together form the key. That means the name alone cannot be the key and the phone alone cannot be the key. But the combination of name and phone is going to be unique. So, in that case, what we will do is we will create another attribute. We will create a composite attribute like I have done ID over here, and this composite attribute will contain these two attributes and this will then become the key. Similarly, over here, if we say that the state and the number, for example, let us say I have state and the number, these two will uniquely form the key. For example, state is UP and it is some number 222, but this number 222 can also be there in the state of Delhi. Okay. Then again, UP can have a number 3533. Now, look, the state alone cannot be the key. Why? Because there is a repetition, and the property of the key is that it must have a unique value for each entity. So, the state alone cannot be the key for the car, right? Similarly, the number cannot be the key for car. Why? Because again there is a repetition. But if we look at all these three rows, we will see that state plus number will always give us a unique value, will always give us a unique value. Hence, we say that state and number together will form the key. But then if we say state and number will together form the key, so that means I will end up writing something like this. Underline. Why? A key is always underlined. Number, underline, and the other attributes that are there. Also, we said vehicle ID is a key. So, basically, and of course, the other attributes are there. So, if I show like this, then what will this mean? This will mean in the ER diagram that state is a what? Key. Because I am underlining this attribute, this will mean that number is a key, and this will also mean that vehicle ID is the key. Whereas, this is not the case, vehicle ID is a key, but state alone is not a key and number alone is not a key. It is the combination of the state and the number that constitute the key. So, what we have done over here is that we have combined state and number into a composite attribute called the registration, and this registration will become the key in the ER diagram. Because when we will actually draw the representational model or a table for this ER diagram, then we will definitely show it as, let's say we draw the schema for car. So, we will write state, number, vehicle ID, year, make, and so on the other attributes. And let's say we choose state plus name as the primary key. I told you there can be a number of attributes which will constitute the key, and we will choose one of them as the primary key. So that this combination, state and number, if we are choosing this combination as the primary key, then in our relational model we will underline both these. But this being not possible over here, what we did, we created a composite attribute. Now, next is domain of an attribute. The domain of an attribute is the set of values which will be assigned to the attributes of the entities in the entity set. That means, I have the entity employee, I have the attributes, let's say SNO and name. So, it is the set of values that will be assigned to the attributes, which means that for example, for SNO, I will have some set of values which will be assigned to the attribute SNO. I can say, let's say I say that that set of values will be integers. For example, if you remember, we had written something like create table employee SNO int name varchar 20. Suppose I write this. So, what is this over here? Int. I am defining the domain of the attribute SNO. That means, the domain of the attribute SNO is all possible integer values. So, this can have only the integer values over here. I cannot write maybe minus 32.5 over here. Why? Because this is not an integer value. So, every attribute will have a domain from which its value will come. Over here we are writing varchar 20 is the domain for name. That means, it can have What is the domain? It is a combination of the 20 characters that can be there. Suppose I write over here, I write another attribute date of birth, which is of the type date, then what will it mean? It will mean that all the possible dates can be the date of birth, right? And the domains, they are specified using the basic data types. That's what I have done. Integer here, these are date. It is a basic data type in structured query language. Varchar is a data type in structured query language. So, they will always be specified using the basic data types. But the domains, they are not displayed in the ER diagram. We have drawn some simple ER diagrams, but we have never displayed the domains in our ER diagram. These will be given only when the database is defined, like we have given the domain over here in this definition of the database. This is all in this lecture. The references for this lecture are these two books. Thank you.